Hey YouTubers, it's me, Lonnie Clark, Nuts for Art. I'm going to continue reading, I only read two pages, from the Human Radiation Studies, Remembering the Early Years, Oral History of Dr. John W. Gofman, Ph.D., M.D., conducted December 20th, 1994, United States Department of Energy, Office of Human Radiation Experiments, 1995, June 1995. So I feel super happy. I just sold a car that I had co-signed on, and the person stopped paying for the car in August, so I've been paying $350 for a car that is dead that I have no rights to. So super happy. Okay, so let me finish this up. I'm going to read about another 10 or 15 minutes. We are on a new subtitle called Attempt to Discredit Gofman's Testimony in Johnston versus U.S. Gofman. I can tell you something. First of all, William Douglas, former Justice of the United States Supreme Court, wrote me some very complimentary letters about my work. He was a great fan of my work, thought I was on the right track. I was a witness in the Karen Silkwood case. Judge Frank Thies was the judge. It was a jury trial. As you know, we won the case. Judge Thies said some very nice things about me. I was back in Wichita, which is his home. He took me out to lunch. Then we had a talk about things like that. Then Judge Jenkins in Utah, the downwinder trial, said some very nice things about me. There's Patrick Kelly in Wichita who said some extremely unnice things about me. I'll tell you something about that case. Gourley, I'd love to hear what you have to say about that case. Gofman, I have a lot to say about that case. There's going to be some developments, I hope, within a year. I can only say that at this point. Which case I don't know about. Long dead history, right? Dead being, I guess, the operative word. Can you give us a hint, Gourley? Gofman, yes. I'm going to have something from major judges of the federal court say something on that. Hefner and Gourley. Oh, good. Gofman. But there is a very important thing about Judge Kelly's decision in Johnston versus the U.S. It is so scary that you might think you're living in Adolf Hitler's Nazi Germany, not in the United States. Let me tell you what it is. I was in to see Carl Morgan, the eminent physicist, the man that I just think so highly of. We were both witnesses in that case. I'm sure you know the scathing condemnation that Judge Kelly provided both Morgan and me. I think he took off on him too. At any rate, I testified and went back to San Francisco. And about 4 weeks later, Ken Peterson, the lawyer, called me up and said, John, when you were being sworn in and examined, we used the fact that there's a plaque which you said was given to you by the Atomic Energy Commission for the discovery of 233 uranium and that fission and its fissionability and that it's on the door of the room where you did the work. I said, yes. What about it, Ken? I have Glenn Seaborg's book showing a picture of the plaque. If you've never seen it, I'll show you the book in the next 5 minutes. Well, that was in parentheses. I think he was making an aside to these two women. Peterson asked, you think it could be that the plaque's been taken down? I said, Ken, are you crazy? That plaque is not going to come down until that building comes down. I said, it's just sitting 10 feet away from the plaque given to Seaborg. That plaque has to be there. I didn't think we'd be calling you to talk to you about this, but I think we'd better, Peterson said. You're pretty sure the plaque is there. I said, of course it's there, Ken. You want me to go over and take a picture of it? Which I did, by the way. What makes you think the plaque isn't there? He's in Wichita, and he thinks my plaque isn't there anymore. So he said, well, they brought up Jacob Frabicant, member of the BIER committee. Jacob Frabicant is from Berkeley. Hefner, he passed away about 2 years ago. Gofman, Frabicant? Hefner, Jacob Frabicant. Gofman, I didn't know that. Hefner, yes, we'll talk about that later. Gofman, I didn't know that. Although I don't speak about the dead, I'll have to. Peterson said they brought Jacob Frabicant in, and this is the conversation paraphrased. Dr. Frabicant, are you on the Berkeley campus? He said, yes. Have you ever gone to by Gilman Hall? He said, yes. Have you ever gone into Gilman Hall? He said, yes. He said, have you ever been on the third floor of Gilman Hall? Imagine this. Jacob Frabicant had about as much business on the third floor of Gilman Hall as I had on the moonshot. He said, did you ever see a plaque on any of the doors on the third floor of Gilman Hall? He said, yes. What did the plaque say? It said, for the discovery of plutonium. No other plaque there? He said, not that I saw. Thank you. So here somebody came in, a professor from Berkeley, who had made a liar out of me. There is no plaque there. And is in effect what Frabicant said in his testimony. So I said, well, Ken, this is serious. I'll go over. O'Connor and I went over and took a picture of a calendar and the plaque on the wall. I'm going to get that picture of the plaque. You ought to see it. The reason I said you, Carolyn, should really worry about this is that you're living in Washington, D.C. Glenn Seaborg was the chairman of the Atomic Energy Commission, who wrote a press release for the AEC in 1968 saying that what a great discovery 233 uranium work was, and that there was reward that they were awarding this bronze plaque to the discoverers of this work. The U.S. Department of Energy and the Justice Department, trying a case in Wichita, act as though they don't know that a different branch of government has announced this $50 quadrillion discovery. There is a plaque in Glenn Seaborg's book. 14 years after this book, they frame up this thing in Wichita. And you ask me to comment on Judge Kelly and the whole shebang? Sure, the plaque's on the door. It's not coming down until the building comes down. Then they'll put it somewhere in the chemistry department. That's the kind of tricks they're up to. Judge Kelly's decision doesn't faze me. But God, they spent a lot of public funds sending out thousands of copies of Judge Kelly's decisions. Where did you get a copy? Gourley, from the law books. Gofman, they sent it out all over the country. I'll tell you about that sort of thing. In Judge Jenkins' courtroom in the Utah case, there was no jury because the trial was against the U.S. government. Anything against the U.S. government, you don't get a jury. Judge Thies in the Karen Silkwood case was a jury. Judge Thies and Judge Jenkins are both just elegant men. If Thies hadn't had a jury in the Karen Silkwood case, I think we would have won based on Judge Thies. But we did have a jury. But when the case came up of Johnston versus the U.S., what did you not know from the law book? There were 19 civilian defendants, companies, in addition to the government. Based upon my deposition and Carl Morgan's deposition, the private companies, plunked down $900,000 not to go to trial. Did you know that? $1,900,000 because they thought the evidence was good against them. When Ken Peterson called, it was the day before they were going to trial, but they all settled except the U.S. government. Ken said, well, let's try it against the U.S. government. I said, Ken, are you crazy? You just got $1,900,000 put in your lab. Anytime you go to court with a judge and no jury, you're taking an awful big chance. It happens occasionally. You'll come out all right, but don't count on it. I'd love to be out of this case now that you're alone against the government because you lose the jury. If one of those civilian defendants had stayed in, we would have a jury in Wichita. Patrick Kelly wouldn't be able to do what he did. But once you don't have anybody but the government, no jury. Ken said, I feel I have to do this for my clients. They think we ought to go after the government, and we have Judge Kelly's decision, including a frame-up using Fabricant as their foil. Well, obviously, folks, this is a case that I don't really know the history of Johnston versus U.S. I guess I'll have to do some work on that. There's a new subtitle. The need for cultural change at the Department of Energy. No shit, Sherlock. Gofman. I thought a lot about that, the government. A lot about the slave empire and the fact that this has got to be changed. When I was talking to Energy Secretary Hazel O'Leary, much of those 2 hours that we talked, I said you need to change that culture so the scientists are not afraid to speak out. All they have to do is to have a Gofman and a Tamplin, and 10 years later, a Mancuso and Alice Stewart, and 5, 10 years later, a Greg Wilkinson, and that's enough to keep all the other slaves in line. You have got to change that culture, which is bad for the country. She said, I'm listening to you. I think she has spoken about a lot about dissidents and about whistleblowers. Hazel's been right on it. She is actually the person who sponsored this oral history. This is who did it. Miss Hazel. I remember her name reading about this. When she came in and discovered that they had kept shoddy records, she ordered an oral history to try to reconstruct it to the best of her ability. In December 1993, U.S. Energy Secretary Hazel R. O'Leary announced her openness initiative. As part of this initiative, the Department of Energy undertook an effort to identify and catalog historical documents on radiation experiments that had used human subjects. So yes, in fact, it was Ms. Hazel. This year, I thought about it in January and February. I called up Glenn Seaborg and I said, Glenn, I think you ought to issue a public apology to me. He said, what are you talking about? I said, I think that to go on with the atomic energy labs, DOE having scientists feel and act as though they are in a slave empire, beautiful facilities, but no freedom to really speak up is a bad thing for science. Amen to you. Let me read that again. I think that to go on with the atomic energy labs, DOE having scientists feel and act as though they are in a slave empire, beautiful facilities, but no freedom to really speak up is a bad thing for science. It's a bad thing for humanity, and it can lead to the wrong answers. Getting credence on health effects that could getting credence on health effects that could eventually hurt millions, hundreds of millions, or even billions of people. You've established an excellent record as a scientist, but as a human being, you don't come across as well. Then he said, why do you say that, Jack? Because you've allowed this thing to go on in your tenure with the AEC, I replied. We talked about it, and I'll come back to that. Well, he said, what do you want? I said, I just want an apology from you and Mike May and Roger Batzel for the fact that you didn't back us up when we did our job. If all of the people working in the Department of Energy labs saw you did this, it could change the culture inside those labs concerning being afraid to speak out. Well, he said, That makes sense. Did you talk to Roger Batzel or Mike May? I said, no, I started with you, figuring that if you didn't do it, they wouldn't. I'll talk to Roger Batzel next. He said, fine. As a matter of a fact, the AAAS meets here in a couple of weeks. We'll call a press conference to do it. He was telling me we could call a press conference for this. So I called up Roger Batzel and told him the same thing and why I wanted it. And he said, it doesn't mean anything to me personally, but I could have a salutary effect. He said, had I talked to Mike May? I said, no, I haven't. He said, well, I'll talk to Mike May. They were supposed to get back to me. About 2 days later, Glenn Seaborg called and said, Mike and Roger won't do it. I said, well, what about you? He said, no, I can't do it by myself. I said, well, that's just pretty bad, Glenn. You really need it. You really need to do something for humanity. He said, look, Jack, I treated you fairly. I said, you did when I worked with you on the uranium-233. I did all the work. You never questioned my honesty. You signed your name to those papers. When I did the work on your 233 uranium and plutonium, you were quite happy to take some of the credit for that. You never worried about it. But when I did the job that you asked me to do, you didn't back me. He said, I did back you. I said, really? You should know that the other commissioners wanted you to do. Excuse me. He said, really? You should know what the other commissioners wanted to do to you. He said, I opted for the lesser sanctions. At that point on the telephone, I blew up and I said, God damn it, Glenn, you've opted for lesser sanctions? I did the damn job you asked me to do, the job I said I would do, and you opted for lesser sanctions when you should have been praising me? I said, you don't really live in the real world, Glenn. You live in Ronald Reagan's world. He said, what do you mean by that? I said, there was a world as it really was, and there was a world as Ronald Reagan would like it to be. I said, you're the same way. There's the world as it really is, and the world that Glenn Seaborg would like it to be. He said, Jack, that's very harsh. He sent me a copy of his new book to John Gofman with my esteem and affection, a whole chapter about darkening clouds and the trouble we caused. Gourley, what sort of marks would you give it for accuracy? Gofman, not good. I called him back and said, you've got some mistakes in it. It wasn't accurate, but it's not bad. In a lot of ways, he did say that we presented our case well. He just thought that it was okay that he opted for lesser sanctions. You know what the sanctions were, don't you? And then there's a new subtitle. AEC responds with sanctions on Gofman's public dissent. I'll end here. I'm going to do another reading tonight. I need to get to work. Busy, busy. Maybe I'll play the lottery, huh? Think that would work? Doubt it. Okay, you guys. Put your courage feet on. Thanks for following the story. I'm going to press through. We're super close to being done, and I want to be done. So, ciao, you guys.